quite an introduction. Thank you so much. I barely recognize myself. I feel like I should go out and say, is she here yet? Thank you so much, Professor Colera. I guess it has been a year or so since I was invited. I do remember corresponding last year, and I do remember saying that I wouldn't be able to make it last year, and I remember being thinking that, well, that's that. And then all of a sudden it happens again, and I was invited. I am deeply appreciative. I thank you so much for inviting me, and I hope it is worth the while. One of the things that stood out for me in your introduction is that I've been doing this for 31 years. It sounds like a pretender in there or something. But one thing I can say, and that is that I have enjoyed all 31 of those years. What I'm going to talk about today is indeed a work in progress. But I want to talk about some other things, share with you some other things before I talk about that work in progress. And I'm going to do that for several reasons. One, I met someone in the hallway today, and they told me that they were very interested in gender. And my talk did not originally pertain to gender. But I said, if this is a student who is interested in gender, then perhaps I should at least spend a little bit of time doing something with that. Should I? So I'm going to spend a little time talking about gender, and I'm going to spend a little time talking about concepts. We're geographers, and we are full of concepts. And so one of the things I'm interested in very much, one of the questions I always ask is, how do these concepts, these things that exist in our mind, how do they play out on the landscape? Because that's what geographers, I think, are interested in. We're interested in how ideas, the ideas we have, ground themselves on the landscape, because we want to see them. So I'm going to spend a little time talking about that. And then finally, I'm going to spend some time talking about what I came to talk about, and that is making invisible cities visible. It is not as long and boring as you think it is. So just bear with me. I'm interested broadly in three things. I'm interested in photography. I'm interested in visuals. I'm interested in what we see. I'm interested in the stories that we can tell with what we see. One of the things I keep in my head is that seeing comes before words. So before we can speak, we see. And so as geographers, we haven't paid a lot of attention to seeing. And what I want to do is sort of make an intervention between words and numbers. And I want to argue that seeing is just as important. And in fact, when we hear words, it conjures images in our mind. So Professor Meek asked me to fly into Ontario Airport. And I immediately said, oh my God, no. I will not fly into Ontario Airport. And why did I say that? Because in my mind, it conjured up an image of me being in this tiny little plane, this two-seater, bouncing all over everything. It conjured up that image. So I flew into LAX, and I took the Metrolink from LAX. Well, actually, I took the, the flyer?
Flyaway.
I took the flyaway. I took the flyaway from LAX to Union Station, and then I got on Metrolink and took Metrolink, the train, here. And when I got here, I said it was great. I passed through all of these little towns, these quaint little villages. And I was corrected, that was the image. And I was corrected yet again. These aren't quaint little villages. These are cities. So I just say that to say, we hear these words, and they conjure a regime of truth. They conjure an image. We associate something with those words. And I'm interested in my work in what does it conjure up? What's the picture that comes to our mind? Likewise, when you're looking at your data sets and you see that there's a community where 33% of the people are below the poverty line, it conjures up an image. We see something. When we see that 4% of the population has a PhD, it conjures up an image. So my interest really is these images that get conjured up, these images that we see when we hear these words and when we see these numbers. I draw from several people, some of them you might have heard of and some of them you might not have heard of because some of them are not geographers. I draw from the work of John Berger, who published a book some time back, Ways of Seeing, and he was very interested in the hidden meaning behind what we see. So, for instance, as an example, you see a word, B-L-A-C-K. And you associate that word with this color. There's no reason that word has to be associated with this color, but it is, and we accept it. But then Berger argues that there's another level of meaning, and that we associate that color with any number of other things. We associate that color with foreboding. We associate that color with, all of a sudden I can't think of anything we associate that color with. But you get the picture. We make associations, so there are levels of meanings that we attach to things. Things denote certain things, and they connote certain things, just based on what we see. I also draw on the work of Gillian Rose. Gillian Rose has published a book that is very famous in visual studies, and it's visual methodologies, because we're geographers and method is important. How we do something is important because we are scientists and it has to be, it should be replicable. If I do something and arrive at a certain conclusion and I give you the same task, you should be able to do that same thing, follow those same steps and arrive at a similar conclusion. Gillian Rose has written a book that talks about visual methodologies, making the argument that, well, it's not numbers based, and it's fairly interpretive, which is somewhat of a problem, but there are methods. There's content analysis as a method to which, with which one can examine photos. So I draw from Gillian Rose's work because method is important. I draw also from the work of Roland Barthes, who has done quite a bit on photos. What do they mean? He asks the question, what does the photo want? And he answers it by saying, it's almost the same thing when you ask the question, woman, what does woman want? He argues that it's power. he argues that it's to be recognized, it's to be understood, it's to be seen as worthwhile. Same thing women want. And I draw on the work of some others, but enough of that. So again, what I'm trying to do in my work is not just take nice pictures and good pictures, which is always a task. But I am trying to make an intervention. I'm trying to let a picture capture something. And I'm trying to take a picture that when you look at that picture, the story becomes apparent. So, let me share one set of photos with you. And with this set of photos, what I'm trying to do is to think about how we think about streets. Let me just say that I work with another photographer. He's in Poland at Wurst, and he and I managed to travel to many places and take photos and come together and say, okay, what do these photos say? So at this particular instance, we were interested in capturing streets. It's a silent photo. I mean, it's a silent PowerPoint. What we were looking at or trying to capture was a linear sequence of images of streets throughout the world. We wanted to broaden our point of view around streets, and always we want to ask questions. We want what we do to give rise to new questions. Questions either, is this the same everywhere? What are the forces that have caused this? Is this the same across all time? Why is this as it is? The purpose is to use photography to think about the familiar landscape. And so in order to ground your thinking, we start out with some definitions. First, what is a street? and the visual term. We were operating in the cultural term, where we sought to make meaning through words. We were operating in the quantitative revolution, where it was numbers, but now we've been at the visual term, where we are making meaning through what we see. And we live in a visual time. We're surrounded with visual information, adverts, films, television. Most of our comprehension of the world comes through the visual. So my interest in geographic education is, can we find a way to incorporate the visual into what we teach? As geographers, can we make it more central to how we understand the world, in addition to the words and in addition to the numbers? And maps are visual representations, by the way. So, I have been smitten with this book, which is on the flyer, and the book is Invisible Cities. And the title was quite provocative, Invisible Cities, Cities You Can't See. What does that mean, Invisible Cities? And so I got the book out of the stacks. It's funny, I now think of it as mine, but it belongs to the library, I guess. Invisible Cities tells the story of two people. One is Kublai Khan, and one is Marco Polo. Marco Polo is this young explorer who's been commissioned by Kublai Khan to go out and look over his empire and to come back and tell him what he sees. Marco Polo will come back and tell Kublai Khan, the emperor, what he sees. So he goes to 55 cities, and he does not speak the language of Kublai Khan, and Kublai Khan does not speak his language, and so he has to find a way to share with him this information about what he sees. So that in and of itself made it interesting to me, because the words and the gestures and the artifacts and things that he brought, that Marco Polo brought, Kublai Khan had to make sense of and get a feel for how his empire was going. And so, let me just read. Marco Polo engages the emperor with tales of cities that he has seen in his travels around his empire. Cities of memory, cities in desire, cities in the dead, trading cities, hidden cities, but very soon it becomes apparent that each of these fantastic places is really the same place. So what was interesting to me was, is there an essential quality to cities? Are cities, is there something about cities that's the same across all space and all time, as this book suggests? So what my colleague B and I did was, yet again, we traveled to all of these cities and we took pictures. That's the good part of being a geographer. And we took pictures and we married the pictures to the text. So there were certain descriptions that Marco Polo gave to Kublai Khan. And we looked to see if those descriptions fit the world as we saw it. And so what I'd like to share with you next is that work. Our argument is that our perceptions and imaginations of cities are shaped by memories, desires, tragedies, and experiences, as well as by the built environment and the cultural forces such as history and language. The peculiarities of time and space matter little. So it's just like my imagination of the airport at
Ontario.
I imagined something. Okay? Nothing was further from the truth but what I imagined.
Do you think the rules can be straight for all children? Any two comments, they imagine a thousand things about one. Meaning each takes place between conversations, surprises, caresses, fights. But no one agrees to me. Eyes lost for a second, then got away, seeking other eyes, never stopping. Something runs among them, an exchange of glances of mind that connects one figure with another and draw arrows, stars, triangles, until all combinations they used up in the moment and other characters come onto the scene. All these beauties will already be familiar to the river, who has seen them also in other cities. Is the city of this dream which one victim? The dreamed of city contains him as a young man. He arrives now in his old age. In the square, there's a wall where the old men sit and watch the young go by. He is seated in a row of them. Desires are already memories. The city, however, does not tell its past, but contains it like the lines of a hand, written in the corners of the street, the gratings of the window, the banisters of the steps, the antenna of the lightning line, the poles of the glass, every segment marked in turn with scratches, indentations, scrolls. Unless the past is destroyed, wiped away with no trace. The city appears as a whole where no desire is lost. And since it enjoys everything you do not enjoy, you can do nothing but inhabit this desire and be content. Such is the problem, sometimes malignant, sometimes benign, that Anastasia, the treacherous city, possesses. If for 8 hours a day you work, your labor, which gives form to desire, takes from desire its form, and you believe you are enjoying Anastasia wholly, when you are only its slave. In the city, rarely does the eye light on a thing, and then only when it has recognized that thing as the sign of another thing. A print in the sand indicates the tiger's passage. The hibiscus flower indicates the end of winter. Finally, you are at the city of Tamar. You penetrate it along streets, thick with signboards jutting from the wall. The eye does not see things, but images of things that mean other things. Other signals warn what is forbidden in a given place. To urinate behind the kiosk, to enter the alley with wagons, and what is allowed. If a building has no signboard or figure, its very form and the position it occupies suffice to indicate its function. However the city may really be, beneath this thick coating of signs, whatever it may contain or conceal, you leave without having discovered it. With cities, it is as with dreams. Everything imaginable can be dreamed. But even the most unexpected dream is a rebus that conceals a desire or a fear. Cities, like dreams, are made of desires and fears. Even if the thread of their discourse is not, their rules are absurd, their perspective is equal, and everything conceals something else. It is the movement of the beholder which gives the city its form. If you go by listening, your nose at tilt behind the whistle, you will know it from below. If you walk along, jingling your head, your nails dug into the palms of your hands, your gaze will be held on the ground, in the gutters, the manhole covers, waste paper. You cannot say that one aspect of the city is truer than the other, but you hear of the upper, chiefly from those who remember it, likewise with the lower. There is little I can tell you about the city beyond the thing its own inhabitants have always repeated. An array of virtues, of faults, a few eccentricities, some punctilious regard for rule. Legions of observers attribute to the city its enduring assortment of qualities, surely comparing them to those of the other cities of their time. Perhaps nothing has changed. But what was bizarre has become usual. What seemed normal is now an oddity. And virtues and faults have lost merit, a dishonor in a code of virtues and faults, differently distributed. In this sense, nothing said of the city is true. And yet, these accounts create a solid and compact image of the city. This is the result. The city that they speak of has much of what is needed to exist, whereas the city that exists, exists less. Everything previously said of the city imprisons your world and obliges you to repeat rather than say. There are three hypotheses about the inhabitants of the city: that they hate the earth, that they respect it so much they avoid all contact, that they love it as it was before they existed, and with spy glasses and telescopes aimed downward, they never tire of examining it, contemplating with fascination their own absence. For those who pass it without entering, the city is one thing. It is another for those who are trapped by it and never leave. There is the city where you arrive for the first time, and there's another city which you never leave to return. Each deserves a different name. If on arriving, I had not read the city's name written in big letters, I would have thought I was landing at the same airport from which I had taken off. The downtown street was made bills, packages, signs that had not changed at all. This was my first time in the city, but I already knew the hotel where I happened to be lodged. I had already heard and spoken my dialogues with the buyers and sellers of hardware. I had ended other day's identity. You can resume your flight whenever you like, they say to me, but you will arrive at another city, absolutely the same, detail by detail.
What we were trying to do was to use this text and imagine what it would look like. I think, going back to teaching, I think if you are in a cartography class or a GIS class, you can use this text and you can map it. Or you could use another text, say Jane Jacobs. Perhaps you've all read Jane Jacobs, The Death and Life of Great American Cities, and you can map it. So again, my work in the area of geographic education is to extend how we think about what we do in the classroom and invite into the classroom things that we had not considered inviting in. I'm going to stop now. There's one other thing I could show, but I'm going to stop if that's okay. So I appreciate your time and your attention, and I'll be happy to entertain questions or comments. Thank you.
Questions?
Fascinating, you know, to see cities, and I think we all have seen these images, isn't it? When we all travel, we